I have an odd background as a linguist. Very lucky, though, I was trained by William Diver at Columbia as a Saussurean semanticist. And I was also trained, I was taught Linguistics 101 by Bill LaBeouf. Variation in sociolinguistics, which many years later, I go to Hunter College to see a lecture by a guy named Leonard Shy, who's a Georgetown professor, who says, we need more linguists involved in the law, because the law is one big analysis of language, and they don't know what they're doing, frankly. So a couple years later, we joined forces. Larry Solan here is another major force within forensic linguistics. He has both a Ph.D. in linguistics, and he's a professor at Brooklyn Law School, and he'll talk later. So I was very lucky, as I was just saying to somebody, because typically we linguists get hired by the defense, and you're always a defense person. But I was hired originally by the Pennsylvania State Police in a murder case, and then the FBI picked me up. So I've been I've been involved against the FBI probably more than the FBI, but they keep hiring me because they know how effective real language analysis can be. So I just want to give you a little introduction to what forensic linguistics is, and then I'll get to the project of my students that I wanted to talk about. So we're always trying to extract information from language evidence. I'm involved with four outfits. One is when I'm hired independently at the bottom there. Hofstra University was smart enough to allow me to start the only forensic linguistics academic program. We have BA and MA, and they're going to add a JD probably with the MA. In the Western Hemisphere, the Brits have three or four schools that give degrees, and the Spaniards do, but we didn't in the United States. The Forensic Linguistics Capital Offense Innocence Project is something I'm really proud of. My students and I reanalyze language evidence that has placed people on death row, just like the Innocence Project uses DNA to show that there was miscarriage of justice. And I'm working with a fabulous constitutional law professor named Eric Friedman at Hofstra with this, and his interns working my interns, and then we present reports to the attorneys in the court. In England, they have the good sense that once you're an expert, you're an expert. It's sort of like having a degree, whereas here, every time I'm proposed testify, the other side throws themselves in front of railroad trains and things to try to get me not to testify, because it's always in their interests for that. So here's my four-year resume, and so far I've been fairly successful. 12 U.S. states, 5 federal district courts, Fry and Gore, and like that, for those of you who've heard of such things. Recent civil cases, that's where we get a lot of lexicography, although we get it in a lot of cases, and it's a murder case that I'm going to present to you. We work for months and months on that should read and or, I just put that in, which you're never supposed to put in a contract, and believe me, you should never put in a contract. And you can find that dictionaries and such are only of small help. As Benji Wald, who was my mentor at Columbia, said with and or as logical operators, they just don't work. He said, I saw a newspaper headline the other day, new law says gays and lesbians and lesbians can now marry. And he said, I thought they always could. So, App Store, where I was Apple's gladiator against good old Amazon and Microsoft, gay bashing, probably the most difficult research I've ever done in my life, analyzing all of the authentic data on how people, what it means in Uganda and Russia, right here, City, whether gay bashing included physical, did it always, did it normally, and just an awful, awful bit of things to have to look at. And pods. What does pods mean? etc. cases. Keeps us very, very busy. The third one up from the bottom, kidnapping text evidence. Guy was accused of kidnapping, attempted strangulation, penetration of the foreign object, and a few other felonies. And he claimed that when he had abducted and incarcerated his estranged wife, he had not been sending texts. She had been sending texts to her new boyfriend saying, you know what, I'm going to go back with my husband, send the kids, send my clothing, and things like that. And just to show you how dangerous experts can be, the defense came with a report from a linguist that showed that indeed she had been texting all those things, where she said, no, I mean, I was tied up half the time. I didn't have access to my phone. When I finally got access to my phone, I texted my mother. He's keeping me, he's raping me, send the cops. The cops came and saved me. So 5 minutes before the hearing, where they're going to figure out reducing his charges or letting him go, the FBI apparently told the prosecutor there in Idaho about me. We did an analysis, went to Walton, and found that I don't know what was the matter with that person who produced that report, because it was total and absolute garbage. It would say, on the one hand, this feature shows that he was texting, therefore she was texting. It was actually that bad. And the problem was, as my students asked me today when I talked about that case, literally, why did they need me if it was so self-contradictory? And I said, because look, I never understand other experts outside of language. They had no idea what that person was talking about. So there's a real, real danger in doing things, I guess, that's always half-assed. And one of the ways we check not to do that is to always do things in teams. So we always check each other's work. Okay, so this case, I was very proud of my students. This was the email from a public defender lawyer in New Jersey, and I'll just, in the interest of time, I'll just summarize things. Two guys arguing, one of them on coke. Finally, he reaches for a knife, opens the knife, and says, so that's the way you want to do it. The other guy takes a kitchen knife and stabs him a couple times and then kills him. So the point was he being challenged? Was he under threat of death himself by the victim saying, so that's the way you want to play? In New Jersey, the heat of passion, you can go to manslaughter. As again, I apologize for this, but I just want to give you some idea. So taking the account at face value, we analyze the phrases, that's the way you want to do it, or you want to do it like that, which were two different versions that the defendant had given. So a team of my graduate students searched for attested uses. We didn't use slip files, but, and of course, what are we going to get in a dictionary? That's the way you want to do it. Among other things, look at all these variations that are possible. That we were asserting that pragmatically were very similar. And my students invented a way of analyzing this. They said that they saw the way things distributed, there were comments and intensifiers. And escalators are what the hypothesis was, that was the trigger for the actual killing. So they talked about comments, they got things from Twitter, from fan fiction, from Newsday, and then intensifiers. Intensifiers instigate the next step in an act, as they pointed out. And either challenges or escalation. And I'll show you, this is fanfic, these are all escalations of somebody saying, so that's the way you want to play it, and then there's real violence. You see, exactly what this defendant was claiming. So it's going to be like that now, you know, start a fight. So it's going to be like that, and look at the last line. It's going to end with somebody decapitating the person. And really good, I thought, was they used was available. So they ended with this, and what I really liked about my students is that they had invented a way of analyzing domains and different semantic components of something that really was very, very important for a murder trial. The guy actually was able to plead to manslaughter, but mostly because the victim had been stabbed in the front, not the back. The idea was that he had been trying to retreat. So anyway, that's some of the overlap of language and a little bit of lexicography anyway with the law. Thank you very much.
For my turn, anyway. small. I've gotten one to my skin.
Right, okay.
Which at that time meant, I'm very in love with you, I'm enamored with you.
Yep.
Use that term today, or you get, you're under my skin. It means you're annoying the shit out of me.
Right, everything depends on the context.
Right, but I'm saying, how do you, what will happen if there's two, in two different communities or whatever, two different, what do you do?
Yeah. And it's not only communities that are which things vary, of course, but it's the pragmatic context. And they did have a whole series of things that were supportive and instructional. And then these, and this was just the tip of the iceberg. This is what we sent the lawyer to perhaps utilize in his openings or closings or something like that. But it's that's one real problem. There's even worse problems with this, because we don't know what the guy actually said. It's the defendant who claimed right. that the other person said it. The mom just said, I don't know, he was talking shit to the defendant, but I don't know what he said. But still, they tried, they volunteered this, and they really exercised their linguistic muscles, I know.
Right, but I'm saying now if you have even one instance, you know, that will, you know, will create doubt in the jury's mind. If you have one, like, even one instance where it's
yeah.
a 180,
yeah.
what happens?
It wouldn't, I believe, because I believe this analysis is correct.
Okay.
And everything is context dependent.
Right,
there's
sure.
nothing more true about that. So you would have to demonstrate a context that was actually identical to this in which it was a 180.
Okay.
And I doubt that would happen. But it's an imperfect question.
It was interesting the way that your students gathered evidence, and you know, in some ways similar to what lexicographers do these days when they're trying to put together evidence to craft a definition, you know, for a word or phrase. But the use of Twitter fan fiction and so forth, again, these are sort of new corpora or media corpora available that are very useful. They often express more informal speech that we
right.
had in writing.
Right. Yeah, there was a slide about that, which was, I mean, just to say that not that you should have read it as it went sipping past, but the all of the actors were African Americans. So we looked first for African American vernacular English, and LeBeau is par excellence, informal speech and utter vernacular is a fight stories, and even more so fights. So we aimed at that register and that dialogue area.
I guess what I'm curious about is what is the general reaction by say judges and other legal professionals to this new kind of evidence, which on the surface may seem rather frivolous
yeah.
or doesn't have the weight of authority of a reference book like a dictionary. Do you encounter problems with people not accepting this as, you know, evidence that's useful?
Science.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. The most important thing I've learned is to show that these are not little surface blips that we thought were interesting correspondences or lack thereof, but that this is based on a good 50 years of people all over the world doing research on variation of sociolinguistics and writing peer-reviewed journals, understanding the principles of variation by language, by dialect, by community of practice, et cetera, et cetera. And that we are really standing on the shoulders of fantastic scholarship, both in semantics and in the variation of sociolinguistics. Does that answer?
Yeah, I guess I was curious especially just about sort of new online communication, which again is useful
yeah.
for kind of
sure.
written forms of things that previously might have been spoken, but might not be taken very seriously.
That's always a problem. And another thing that I've learned is never make any jokes. And never have frivolous scenarios, and you can avoid them. But this would have been presented, if I had believed enough in the data and I had testified, as so deadpan, and as instances of, I would have had to explain, you know, above what we said, that what you do when you testify is you teach linguistics. And you have to teach linguistics to the judge in your evidentiary trial, hearing, and then you have to teach linguistics to the jury. So that's what you have to do. One of the things apparently is different about me than some other experts is that I always look at the jury, which you're sort of supposed to do. And I always like make believe that they are my old linguistics 101 classes that I would teach three per semester for 15 years. perfect training too, because I have heard every outlandish question in the world, like in cross examination. So it's always a difficult thing. And if we can deduce a great variety of sources, we do. Maybe I shouldn't have used this as my example, but I've used, you know, a real one, so to speak, that I would, that I did testify on. And then you will see. Mm-hmm.
Can you please talk about the Ohio one?
Which one?
The one that is near the street.
The Devil's Strip. Yeah, well, that's a famous one, the Devil's Strip. Linguistic demographic profiling. If you ever want to see your precious little daughter again, leave $5,000 in the trash can on the Devil's Strip at 3rd and Main. Right? No cops. Any cop, any police, daughter is dead. Daughter is misspelled. Cops is misspelled. Or are misspelled. But precious is spelled correctly. The thing that hit me the best, and what I always try to explain to our user group, is that we are looking under the surface. When I present that case to, say, forensic psychologists or criminal profilers or something, they immediately pick up on the K, or cops as in Keystone Cops, or trash can, the K. But Fourth and Carlson is with a C. So what we're always trying to do is look beneath the surface. And one of the things you see instantly if you're trained is that the punctuation is perfect, even though daughter is misspelled, even though cops is misspelled. And it's also extremely well written in some other ways, and it has this thing, Devil Strip. Now, the Devil Strip was the marker for Roger Schein to instantly say, ah, where is this person from? Of course, he's from Akron, Ohio. Because only in Akron, Ohio is that strip of grass between where you walk and the cars go called the Devil Strip. In Nassau County, it's called a county strip. What do you guys call it? You probably don't have a word for it. See? And that was another reason that this guy did not realize it. He figured everybody called it a Devil Strip. He didn't realize he was tattooing "I'm from Akron" on his forehead. The other thing Roger said was that he was probably educated in dumbing down. It's hard to dumb up. And on the suspect list, and we can only narrow suspect lists, there was a well-educated man from Akron, Ohio.
In northeast Kansas, it was called parking.
Parking. Oh, that's good. I have this big picture, a big thing off the web somebody got me, which says, no parking on Devil's Strip.
What was your goal in presenting this, or planning to present it, was to prove what? Was it that, yes, this is kind of construction, is used in this context, or it was reasonable for the guy to think that, which is a little step beyond that, or was it, or what was several possible levels?
Great question, and the answer will, I think, enlighten a lot of the other answers, which is, one of the reasons I'm as successful as I am is I don't overstep my science. I don't then say, therefore, so-and-so killed him. I never even say, in authorship cases, that John Smith wrote it. I say that the comparing hypotheses, that's what we were taught at Columbia, that's what always and only did, was compare competing hypotheses. Which better explains the linguistic patterns in the anonymous document? That they are instances of the same kind as corpus A, corpus B, corpus C, corpus D. And by showing strings of correspondences with D, that's all I say. And I always have in my authorship reports, this is not to say that John Smith therefore wrote it. That's something only for the trier of fact. And any of you who are involved in the law know that if you try to invade the province of the trier of fact, you won't be allowed, nor should you be. So all I do is tell the linguistic facts, I present it, and then the judge or jury takes it from there. Does that answer your question?
Well, I guess the question was, specifically, I mean, the sort of the base level, the simple, the most, the least aggressive thing to, I can see using that for, you just said this construction can be used in the context of an intensifier.
Well, you see, yeah, what we say, that's right.
But then beyond that, you might say, well, it was reasonable for him to think that, or that's the most likely, that's more likely than the other possible uses. I mean, there's different levels, I guess, of what. how far you can take the conclusions while still talking just about the linguistics of it. You know, was there a particular level that you were shooting for?
No.
Okay.
The other thing, the other reason that I've been as successful as I have been is because I have never said I am. Lawyers will ask, are you likely, more likely, likely bordering on certainty or something? There's no way that I know of to put a numerical value on the strings of features. And if I say, oh, I'm about 75%, I'm just leading with my chin, as my old judge, boxer, father would have said. You know, instead of leading with a left, you lead with your chin to get hit. Because then a very good question is, oh, well, what would it take to be 74%? Or 76, what is this feature, is this, so all I ever do, and if it's not sufficient unto the day, then sue me, so to speak, then fine, which is the superior competing hypothesis? And of course it has to be a fairly strong case, but I never numericize it, and I never, which the old forensics do always, and a lot of forensic linguists, as Larry knows very, very well, got into a lot of trouble trying to say certainty, you know, order answer.
So do you have a sense that this kind of instruction originates in movies? So I mean, it's, you know, it's sort of, and that's where people get it from? I mean, because I don't know, do people actually say this as an intensifier or an escalator?
Evidemment.
What term?
Evidemment, apparently.
Well, no, but I mean, a lot of those were from movies, and maybe did they get it by...
Because they were available to us. Another way of doing this would have been to do the Lebovian linguistic interviewing and go out into the community and figure out some way to elicit that data, but we only had 2 weeks. And that's another real problem with forensic linguistics. Sometimes I have this much data only, and it has to be by next Monday. So, and in one of my greatest cases, the person reporting out said, he was very good to me, he said, Leonard said, you know, we normally have months to do this, you only gave me an hour. And this is when my crowning glory, the heck with murders and stuff like this, I was able to out Kanye West as tweeting using his wife Kim Kardashian's phone. And I mean, it's nice to deal with something that's really valuable. The Daily News asked me if I could tell whether Kim or his husband Kanye had done these nasty tweets to Bette Midler and some actors, and I was able to say yes. And they were very good because they took it for what it was worth. And what I love so much about that case is that the stakes were so low. Yes, ma'am.
I was wondering, are you familiar with the recent California lawyer being prosecuted? I think it might have been a federal case for being sentenced to 30 years in prison for prescribing opioids to a patient. No, I'm sorry, a doctor, a California doctor.
Was there linguistic evidence involved?
I'm not sure, but I'm wondering if you're familiar with it. And if
no,
oh, okay.
I not that I can remember. Typically, I am always asked.